you need some study guides, those online, you can go to the book daniel.com. Otherwise, if you've missed studies, you can get it there in the foyer. Did everyone receive a study here today? Okay, we are studying which book? The book Daniel. And so this is a prophetic book in God's Word, and we have been studying this, and today we are getting to chapter 10, Christ the what? Christ the warrior. And this is where we are now. We are headed to the last vision in this book of Daniel. It's quite extensive, covering chapter 10 to 12. But before we start, we're going to ask God's Spirit to lead us. Amen? Let's just close the eyes as we ask God's presence. Oh, Father, we need your help as we open your prophetic word. And Father, only you can show to us the depth of your prophetic truth. And Father, we pray that the Spirit may teach us, that the Spirit may guide us now. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our text we've been looking at is 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19. What does it say? We have also a what? A more sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well that you take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a what place? A dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in our hearts, in your hearts. This day star is who? It's Jesus Christ. So as we're going to study prophecy, as we're going to open our Bible, this is about who? This is about Jesus. Now, this is quite a different picture today. He's pictured here as a warrior, and not all the time we think of Jesus as a warrior. But today we're going to start seeing this, and especially through chapter 11 to 12. Now, the first section we're going to dive right into our study guides is section 1. Daniel prays and fasts again. Now, please note, it has been observed that the apocalyptic prophecies of Daniel 2, 7, 8, and 9 build upon one another. Amen? We every time saw their recapitulation taking place, enlargement, and the one building on the other, and our picture has been expanding about what the future holds. Now, one prophecy remains to follow this recapitulation, and that is the prophecy of Daniel 10 to 12, which is a single prophetic vision that Daniel receives. Many times I'm frustrated when people take these chapters as if it's standing on its own. It's not. It's one whole unit. Chapter 10 then serves as the introduction to chapters 11 and 12. Enough said, let's go to our Bibles. If you can open your Bible to Daniel chapter 10, and we're going to read the first verse. Daniel chapter 10, verse 1. It says, in the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a thing was revealed unto who? Unto Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar. And the thing was true. But the time appointed was long, and he understood the thing, and had understanding of the vision. Now, the first question right out of the box here, what is this thing that was revealed to Daniel? Please write there in your study guide, the prophetic vision of Daniel 10 to 12. This is the thing that he saw. This is the thing that it's speaking about here in this text. And you will see in a moment how we know this. But please write there, the prophetic vision of Daniel 10 to 12. So he's starting describing, okay, something is going to happen, and I'm going to explain to you what has transpired with me and in my mind when I was in vision. Right. So how do we know this? Now, the Hebrew word for thing in this text is debar, which means an account. So he's speaking about the account. The account we're going to read in chapter 10, 11, and 12. So Daniel is referring to the prophetic account or vision that he receives in Daniel 10 to 12. At the end of this verse, Daniel says that he had understanding of the vision. Now he uses a different word. Now, let me just pause there. Do you remember when we studied Daniel 8? It was observed that the complete prophetic vision of Daniel 8 was described by the Hebrew word chason. The whole vision was chason. But there was also the 2,300-day prophecy
and it was described by the Hebrew word mare. Now here in Daniel chapter 10 verse 1, Daniel uses the word, the Hebrew word again, mare, indicating that he finally understood what prophecy? The 2,300 day prophecy. Literally says, and I had understanding of the vision, the mare. Amazing. So it should be noted, also in this very verse, it says, in the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia. So it should be noted that this prophetic vision takes place in the third year of Cyrus. After the Hebrew exiles began returning to Jerusalem in the first year of Cyrus. That's an important thing to note. And Daniel, did Daniel go with them? No. By this time, Daniel was a very old man. He could not go with them all the way back to Jerusalem that were destroyed 70 years earlier. Okay, let's go back to Daniel chapter 10. We are reading verse 2 to 3. In those days, I, Daniel, was mourning how long? 3 full weeks. I ate no pleasant bread. Neither came flesh nor wine in my mouth. Neither did I anoint myself at all, till 3 whole weeks were fulfilled. He was literally praying and fasting and praying for 3 weeks. Why? Why did Daniel fast and pray? What was on his mind? What have we been seeing through Daniel chapter 8, 9 and 10? What is on his mind? Please write in. For the fulfillment of the 2,300 day prophecy. At last he got to understand it. Now, after concluding chapter 9, he says in the first verse of chapter 10, I understand it. But now he's praying about it. Okay? He's praying about the details of it to be fulfilled. Now, if you have your study guide, please go to page 2 with me. We're going to read a few words about this understanding and this prayer he has. On page 2, that in verse 1, Daniel says that he now understands the 2,300-day prophecy. Are we all there? Okay, so we understand it. He then describes his fasting and prayer for a full 3 weeks, indicating that his declaration of understanding the 2,300-day prophecy and his prayer are what? Related. The very moment he finished talking about understanding it, he's talking about his prayer and fasting. So the two are related. What do we know? Something happened in this very time he was praying. We know when it was. The third year of Cyrus. The beginning of this 2,300-day prophecy starts with a command to rebuild Jerusalem. You remember that? We saw that in Daniel chapter 9. When the 490 years that are cut off from this prophecy, both start at the same date, when the command goes forth to rebuild Jerusalem. Which means that Daniel prays primarily for Cyrus and against the opposition to the rebuilding of Jerusalem. Because something happened in that very time. Here it is. The challenge Daniel prayed about was not the Jews returning to Judea, as that had already been accomplished by Cyrus's decree. He said they can return. Instead, he prayed about the trouble the Jewish people encountered after arriving in Jerusalem. According to the book of Ezra, the returnees faced difficulties when trying to rebuild Jerusalem and the temple, specifically with the Samaritans, who offered to help but were refused due to their polytheistic and idolatrous practices. And they then turned to obstructionism, hiring counselors to work against the Jews, successfully halting the construction of the temple for a prolonged period. These counselors likely worked at the court of the king, getting the ear of the monarch and his advisors to achieve their goal. Are we all there? So can you see there's a whole challenge? Now the king decreed that they can return. The next decrees we'll find later officially said, you can do this, that are being opposed now. But Daniel, he knows the prophecy should be fulfilled, and he's praying, oh God, please break through that you can work in Cyrus' mind, that your work can be done and the prophecy be fulfilled. Do you see this? But part of this prayer, the last paragraph, however, Daniel's greater concern is about the implication of the 2,300-day prophecy, which points to an antitypical day of atonement. Therefore, he prays that the sanctuary will be cleansed for a full understanding of the prophecy and for God's people during this time of judgment. Because he knows the day of atonement that is going to come after this, in his mind, he saw all the connections. Today, we in hindsight can say, okay, this was thousands of years. In his time, of course, he didn't know exactly how long and where it's going to end. But what he knew is there's a day of judgment coming, and God's people need to be prepared. Amen? And so he's praying for this, and he's praying for his own life too. Listen to this verse, and it's going to relate to us too in our context today. Blow the trumpet where? In Zion. This is in God's church. Sanctify a fast. Call a solemn assembly. Gather the people. Sanctify the congregation. Should we call the church to higher holiness? To deeper repentance? Absolutely. This is God's call in His Word. Assemble the elders. Gather the children and those that suck the breast. Let the bridegroom go forth of his chamber and the bride out of her closet. Let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep between the porch and the altar. Let them say, spare thy people, O Lord. Give not thine inheritance to reproach, that the heathen should rule over them. Wherefore should they say among the people, where is their God? Are we in a time that we should repent? Is this applying to our lives? This leads us to this question. Why should God's people fast and pray today? Why? Please write in your study guide. We are living in the time of judgment and should seek Christ. We are living in the time where we should weep between the porch and the altar, where we should call God's people one another to deeper repentance, humility, and seek God's face. We are living in the time where we saw from 1844 the investigative judgment has started. We are living in the antitypical day of atonement where we do not know when it's going to end. We don't know when our life will end. And we should be repenting. Amen? We should be transformed by the grace of Christ. That's why it's now the time to seek Christ. This leads us to section 2. Christ reveals himself to Daniel. You know, when we seek Christ, do you think we're going to find him? What is Matthew 7, 7? Ask and it shall be given. It says knock and it shall be opened. Let's read Daniel chapter 10, verse 4 to 5. And in the 24th day of the first month, as I was by the side of the great river, which is Adikal. Okay, so this is now after he's fasting. He's still praying, he's still contemplating. Something marvelous happens. Then I lifted up my what? My eyes and looked, and behold, a what? A certain man. Daniel is seeing a man. Who reveals himself unto Daniel? Please write in your study guide, Jesus Christ. This man is none other than Jesus Christ himself. Now, I remember when I shared this in a Bible study quite a while ago, someone asked me, how do you know it is Jesus Christ? How do you know? Let's read it. Okay, I'm going to read verse 5 and 6 and see the picture, what Daniel saw. And you tell yourself, is this Christ or not? Verse 5, then I lifted up my eyes and looked, and behold, a certain man clothed in what? In linen, whose loins were girded with fine gold of Uphaz. Now please note, I just want to stop here. The high priest on the Day of Atonement wore what clothing? White linen, okay, with some gold around his waist and a golden band that said holiness unto the Lord, okay, on the Day of Atonement. Daniel is praying about this very time that will come, the antitypical Day of Atonement. Now he goes into vision and he sees Christ wearing what? The garments of the high priest on the Day of Atonement. Girded with fine gold of Uphaz. Verse 6, his body also was like the beryl, and his face as the appearance of lightning, and his eyes as lamps of fire, and his arms and his feet like in color to polished brass, and the voice of his words like the voice of a multitude. Now, if you compare this with what John saw on the Isle of Patmos, it's the same person that both saw. And we know that John saw Jesus. Just look at that comparison on your study guide. In Daniel, it's a certain man. In Revelation, it's the Son of Man. In Daniel, he's clothed in linen. In Revelation, he's clothed with a garment. In Daniel, it's his loins is girded with fine gold. In Revelation, gird about the paps with a golden girdle. Then Daniel, his face is as the appearance of lightning. In Revelation, his countenance as the sun that shineth in all his strength. And then in Daniel, his eyes as lamps of fire. In Revelation, his eyes were as flames of fire. In Daniel, his feet like in color to polished brass. In Revelation, his feet like unto fine brass. In Daniel, his voice as of a multitude. In Revelation, his voice as the sound of many waters. Is this Jesus? Oh, that is Jesus. Isn't this amazing? Daniel is seeing Jesus in vision. Let's read verse 7 to 9. What is happening as Daniel is hearing vision? And I, Daniel, alone saw what? The vision. Okay? For the men that were with me saw not the vision, but a great quaking fell upon them, so that they fled to hide themselves. Therefore I was left alone and saw this great vision, and there remaineth no strength in me, for my comeliness was turned in me into corruption, and I retained no strength. Yet heard I the voice of his words, and when I heard the voice of his words, then was I in a deep sleep on my face, and my face toward the ground. Oh, this is amazing. I wish we had more time just to compare this with Revelation. But take your study guide, please, and go with me to page 4, at the bottom paragraph on page 4, and then the top paragraph of page 5. We're going to read this. This, to me, is critical. We all, in this time of judgment we are living in, should seek the face of Jesus. Amen? What is the experience God wants for us? On page 4, the vision of Christ's glory is profound and life-changing. As Daniel sees Christ in vision, he experiences what all will experience who truly see Christ for who he is. When John sees Christ in all his glory on the Isle of Patmos, he falls down like a dead man. When Job saw Christ for himself, he abhorred himself and repented in dust and ashes. When it dawned on Peter who Christ really was, this is on page 5, he fell down in front of Christ, repenting of his sin. One glimpse of the glory of Christ is a light that pierces our soul to its very core, exposing our inner sinfulness in contrast to his lovely holiness of love. Amen. When Isaiah saw the Lord seated on his throne in his holy temple, he was overcome with his sin, felt like dying, and what did he do? He repented. Beloved, why don't we repent like we should in this day of judgment we are living? Because we are not beholding Christ. The more we see Christ, the more we're going to see our own sinfulness and the need to repent of it. Now the next paragraph, the good news is that Christ will not leave you in despair. Some people don't want to be confronted with their sin. They fear this feeling of despair and guilt. No. He won't leave in despair due to the conviction of the filthiness of your sin. He will cleanse you and transform you. Amen? He's going to deal with your sin, for he has a plan and a mission for your life. Similarly, Daniel had to go through this cleansing process in the presence of Christ to prepare him for the prophetic journey through time, that which he's going to see and go into the future in Daniel 11 and 12. But before he can go there, he needs to be prepared. Amazing. Now, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, 9 says, and he said unto me, my grace is what? Sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect, how? In weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. God is God. Though my sin, though despair, though guilt, he will come and transform me and cleanse me and take away that sin. The question is, do I behold Christ? Will I behold Christ? That last two paragraphs on page 5, please follow with me. Christ can only work in you when you recognize your true condition and your need for his grace. Amen? Do you see that? That's why the world don't repent, because they don't see Christ for who he is. It was when those called by God saw the glory and holiness of Christ and the unworthiness that they could be entrusted with a divine mission and message. Only when you had been led to distrust yourself, be cleansed of sin and self, and fully depend on Christ, can you fully embrace your divine mission. Do you know that every one of you sitting here today, everyone listening at this very moment, that God has a special plan for your life? That it's no accident that you are living in this time of this world's history now, in judgment time. But in order for God to use you, I need to come to that point of surrender, where I can be cleansed and transformed by Him. But it only happens as I behold Jesus Christ. The last paragraph says it all. Besides Daniel's spiritual experience of deep repentance and cleansing, which it be our experience too, he underwent a physical reaction, unlike ours, since he was a prophet. And he went into vision. And since Daniel is in a prophetic vision that I will never be, I'm not called as a prophet, he's undergoing the bodily experiences that biblical prophets encounter when receiving prophetic visions. Please note how his body responds while he's in vision. I'm going to put it on the screen. Okay, here is Daniel. He goes into vision and something happens to his body. What happens to his body? Please note, his eyes are what? Open. Now, you will see in a moment why it's actually strange. His ears can hear. Those, they are all the scriptures for it. He falls face forward to the ground. That's why I know it's a false spirit in many churches today where everyone falls backward. The Holy Spirit never slays anyone backwards. It's always forwards in Scripture. Always. So here he falls forward, face to the ground. Then he's physically unconscious. That's what the text tells us. He has no life in him and he's emptied of all strength. And then we see he's supernaturally strengthened. That's why it's like, oh wow, this is incredible, because there's no life in him, he's unconscious, and yet his eyes are open. His ears can hear. He's literally going into another dimension while his body is lying there. Can you see this? I want you to see this. Because later on, we need to see the parallels to understand what Daniel is going through as the angel is preparing him for this prophetic time travel into the future in Daniel 11 and 12. We get to section 3. Daniel is strengthened. Let's go to verse 10 in Daniel chapter 10. It says, and behold, a hand touched me. He was falling face forward down on the ground. He's unconscious. Behold, a hand touched me, which set me upon my knees and upon what? The palms of my hand. He's trying with the strength that's given him by this angel to try and revive, to try and get to the place where he can focus on what the angel wants to tell him. What angel is coming to him? It's Gabriel. It's the same angel in chapter 8, chapter 9. Now we see he does the very same thing. He's the one that take him on prophetic visions, the angel Gabriel. Now please note verse 11. It says, and he said unto me, O Daniel, a man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak unto thee, and stand upright, for unto thee am I now sent. And when he had spoken this word unto me, I stood trembling. Why is he trembling? Daniel is an elderly man. And this is draining. This is a draining experience. First seeing Christ in vision, hearing him, seeing all the experience of his majesty and glory. This is draining. Even being in vision is draining. So Daniel is trembling at this point. But what we're going to note throughout, and later I'll show you out of Scripture, he is still in vision. When Gabriel comes to him, Gabriel comes to him in vision. Okay? You will see this in a moment. Now we go to section 4. Gabriel encourages, emphasizes, and explains. He first strengthens, then encourages, then emphasizes something very specific, and then he explains. Let's read verse 12. Then said he unto me, fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that thou didst set thine heart to understand and to chasten thyself before thy God, thy words were what? Heard. And I'm come for thy words. Question. When Daniel started praying and fasting, did God hear his prayer? It says the very first day. Amen. It says your words were heard. When I pray, does God hear?
Sometimes some people feel he does not. Why? Can there maybe be a problem? Now in verse 13 we see, oh yeah, something happens at times. And he said unto me, this is verse 13, but the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. But lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. Now, there's some detail I want to emphasize, and then we're going to move on. There on your study guide, on page 7, the middle paragraph, it's going to continue what we said in the beginning, that there was some situation going on with the king and the Jews in Jerusalem that returned with King Cyrus. Now, the middle paragraph, page 7, it says, the Samaritans continued to oppose the Jews' efforts to rebuild Jerusalem and the temple, weakening their hands and troubling them with false reports that aroused suspicion. The controversy was a fierce struggle between good and evil, with all heaven interested in the outcome. The forces of evil were led by an evil angel general called the Prince of Persia, who did everything in his power to inspire Cyrus to be against the Jews and their rebuilding efforts in Jerusalem. Can you see what's happening? Satan with his forces are withstanding and trying to influence this king to be against the Jews that returned to Jerusalem and to believe the false reports. But at the same time, like the forces of evil are working, God's forces of good are working. Amen? The forces of good, led by Gabriel and later Christ himself, worked to counteract the influences at work on the mind of Cyrus, ultimately gaining the victory and holding back the enemy's forces for all the days of Cyrus and his son Cambyses. This was a time of great opportunities for the Jews, with the highest agencies of heaven working on the hearts of kings. I won't go into that detail. They didn't really use the opportunity and what God provided for them. But in any case, the point is that there's this great struggle going on between good and evil, and now it's embroiled even in the mind of King Cyrus here in Persia and there in Babylon. And this is where Daniel was praying for. And now the angel explained to him, something happened. Why does God sometimes delay in answering our prayers? Is this a good, important question? Many people are wrestling with this. Why? Why does God sometimes not answer my prayers? Or why does he delay? Or why does it take so long? For years, there's no result. You know, what is going on? Is there something spiritually wrong with me? Gabriel explains that the delay is due to the great cosmic battle between Christ and Satan. Amen? Do you see that? We are in a what? Write in your study guide. In a war. We need to see this. If we have a problem when it comes to prayer or God, we need to realize the very first thing, the basic foundation is we're in a war. And prayer is an act of warfare. Please write that in your study guide. It's an act of warfare. Whenever I pray, it's not just, okay, I'm sending a little message in a bottle and throwing it on the ocean. What? Whenever God feels like someday in 25, 50 years, he will open the bottle and read my message. And maybe he'll send something back. No, that's not prayer. Prayer is an act of warfare. Are we all there? Listen to this. We're going to study this for a moment. Now, in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 18, Paul writes and he says, this charge I commit unto thee, son Timothy, according to the prophecies which went before on thee, that thou by them mightest war a good warfare. So here he's saying, Timothy, I want you to fight the good fight. Now, what? With who's Timothy fighting? What should he fight? How should he fight? The good fight must be fought because we're in a war, but how? Let's continue the passage. Paul writes to Timothy, holding faith and a good conscience, with some, which some having put away concerning faith, have made shipwreck, of whom is, and now he mentions people and church problems and stuff, and he says he has delivered them unto Satan, but then he gets to verse 1 of chapter 2. I exhort therefore that first of all, supplications, prayers,
intercessions and giving of thanks be made for what? All men. Paul is writing to Timothy, he said, you should fight. And then he said, you should pray, supplicate. You should pray intercessory prayer. You should intercede. Are we all there? Why should we intercede? Because God is saying this is an act of warfare. Listen to what Ephesians chapter 6, 12 says. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against what? Principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Is there a war going on? Are we in the middle of this war? Absolutely. And we are wrestling. We have these challenges every day. Then Ephesians 6, it lists all the armor we should put on. And take the helmet of salvation. And then it says, take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. There are two things he lists here. While Ephesians 6 lists different spiritual defensive armor parts, it confirms that as Christians we have two offensive weapons. What are these? It's the Word of God and prayer. Do you know that prayer is a weapon? Can you see it now? So how do we use prayer? I think that's a very important question. How do we use prayer? We need to understand there are demonic strongholds in people's lives, including our own, that we should tear down through our prayers. Go and study 2 Corinthians 10. We have to break the enemy's plans. Now, please note, it's plans that prevent the knowledge of God. Why plans? Because it means that Satan's forces are very organized. How do we know his forces are organized? In Mark 5, verse 9, Jesus asks the demon who he is. And the demon answers what? I am what? Legion. This is a military term referring to an organized regiment with a commander over them. Which means Satan is organized. And in the Roman times, one legion consisted about 5,000, maybe sometimes to 6,000 soldiers. It's a lot of soldiers. Totally organized. Satan is organized. On God's side are the unfallen angels who are also highly organized. In Gethsemane, Jesus told Peter that he could instantly summon 12 legions of angels. Within these forces, there are also authority structures. And we can see then, okay, we are in a real war, day by day, moment by moment. So how does this war work in terms of our prayers? Because our prayer is a weapon in this war. In Daniel 10, Daniel prayed continually for how many days? 21 days or 3 weeks. From the very first day, God heard his prayer and immediately sent Gabriel to answer it. Amen? Wow. So because of your words, God sends angels to intervene for what you pray for. Amazing. But can we think that God is unwilling to answer prayer and that we must plead and plead? Because some people think, oh, you know, that is why it takes so long. God wants me to be on my knees for 20 years, and then he said, okay, you've shown me. Now I'll answer you. Is that God? No, it's not God. No, as soon as we pray, God wants to intervene. So why did Gabriel take 3 weeks to arrive on earth with God's answer? Or did he? Listen again to verse 13 of Daniel 10. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 120 days. But lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. So who is this prince of Persia? Who is this prince of Persia? It's a fallen angel commanded by Satan to rule over the kingdom of Persia. That is his territory, and all the other angels there is under him. So when Daniel prayed, God said to Gabriel, go and answer his prayer. Okay, so Gabriel comes to the earth. Gabriel went, but he was stopped by this demonic force that did not want to let him break through to Cyrus's mind. And for 21 days he fought, but Gabriel was not successful. So what did Gabriel have to do? What did he do? He called on Michael. He had to get reinforcements by calling in Michael. Amen? Wow. It says there, but lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me. And I remained there with the kings of Persia. Now, the logical question that I've heard many times, why aren't there other angels assisting Gabriel and helping him? Why Michael? Now, before we get to Michael, where's the other angels? You see, the whole world is embroiled in a war. This means all the angels are fighting everywhere. You know, these Christian pictures of the angels sitting with a feminine little wings on a cloud, playing a little harp, that's unbiblical, amen? Angels are warriors, amen? They are fighting every day so that we can go to heaven. While Gabriel is trying to break through, all the other angels are engaged in their own battles all over the world. And so, before I can get to where I want to go with prayer, we have a problem with sin. And this is like Achilles' heel to all of us in this warfare going on at this very moment. Why is sin our Achilles' heel in this war? You see, when we sin, we identify ourselves with the enemy, and not getting rid of that sin gives the enemy a legal foothold in our lives. Do you see that? And so he can say, oh, but I claim him or that home for myself because they are inviting me in. As an example, let's quickly go to Moses. Moses, he was a warrior for God here on earth. He sinned by striking the rock and he could not enter the promised land. He had to die outside of the promised land, but God wanted Moses with him because Moses recognized and confessed his sin before he died. And so God wanted to resurrect Moses, yet Michael the archangel, this is, I'm quoting now Jude 9, when contending with the devil, disputed over the body of Moses and did not bring against him a railing accusation. But he said, the Lord rebuke thee. Michael waged war with who? With Satan over Moses' body. Satan opposed Christ and said, no, he's mine. He made choices in accordance with my kingdom. And what did Michael say? The Lord rebukes you because he legally forgave Moses. But do you see, the point of this is Satan claims to the wrongdoing in our lives, to where we gave him a foothold and a legal part. I said, listen here, he invited me in, so that is mine. You see, he could state this, Jesus now, to Satan, because he himself would one day come to die and legally redeem every person as his property through his blood. Amen? This is a real war. And that's why Jesus said, now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men where? Unto me. So Satan lost all authority at the cross. Here he was unmasked and overcome. Through the cross, Jesus, who redeemed us as his property, gave the angels the right to work for us on this planet, even before the cross, on the credit that Jesus would die in the future. Do you see that? So let's go to a verse in Revelation, because we're looking at prayer, the great cosmic conflict, and the angels. Here it says, and out of the throne, that's God's throne, proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices, and there were seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. Now here's the question. What are these lightnings and thunderings out of God's throne? Please note the verse in Ezekiel. And the living creatures ran and returned as the appearance of a what? A flash of lightning. So these lightnings and thunderings out of God's throne are angels speeding back and forth to prayers answered the whole time. Do you see this? Because we are in a warfare. They are always before God and at God's command. They are in any place where God sends them in answer to our prayer. And God always answers our prayers with his full attention and from his heart. Amen? You better believe this. I cannot come in prayer, and I dealt this with the previous study, with the conditions of prayer. I cannot come to God, and the first thing is like, I don't have faith. Oh, he's not going to hear me. Let me try, but he's not going to hear. It's almost like going fishing. I just put in the hook in the water. I don't think, but let's try. There's no bait, there's no faith, there's no nothing. When I pray, I come with intention and expectation. Amen? Is God's heart hard towards you? No, never.
Never think that if the outcome does not materialize immediately, God doesn't want the best for you. Always believe that when you pray, God hears and sends angels to answer your prayer. Always. So why is there delay? Coming back to my original question. There are other beings also involved to try to prevent the answer. So if there's a delay, keep praying. Amen? You must persist. Not because God is unwilling, but because there's a war going on. And we have looked at some of the legal reasons throughout these studies, because all of Daniel is based in this greater context of the cosmic conflict between good and evil. So you must show that you are serious about having God at work in the given situation. It's not about convincing a reluctant God, but about demonstrating your commitment in a spiritual battle. Do we have freedom of choice? Absolutely. And for God to respect that, He cannot just do as He wants without our persistent prayer. Now I'm coming to the very core of the matter, the very heart of the matter. Listen carefully now. For instance, I cannot ask God to be with my family once in passing and then never bring it up again. Let's say for 5 years. Is that a real prayer? Can such a prayer work powerfully in a constant war against the enemy? No, there's no way. What will the enemy think of such a prayer? Oh yeah, this is a man of faith and prayer. No. He can use that and say, listen here, Christ, it's clear he does not mean what he's praying for. He might conclude that you don't love your family, but if you pray seriously and keep on praying, what does that show everyone? That you care and really want God to intervene. This gives God the mandate and legal right to intervene in that situation. If God were to intervene without our consistent prayers, Satan could argue that people's lifestyle and sporadic prayers show they do not really want God involved. And God cannot go against our free choice. And Satan is thus using our free choice against God, saying, you see, they're not really choosing you, so you cannot intervene. Whereas when we pray and intercede, it's a weapon of war. We give God the right to act. Persisting in prayer shows you are serious and want what you are petitioning for. Amen? So what is God praying for? You know, I put in quotation marks, God doesn't pray, but what is God's desire? What is His prayer of His heart? What is His desire? What does He want? Because we are so quick to blame God. So many times I'm dealing with people that are questioning God. You know, why doesn't He? Why this? Why that? And they're blaming God. This is God's desire. Listen carefully. Ezekiel chapter 22:30. And I sought for a man. Is there a man here today? The same with a woman. God wants a woman, a real woman, a real man. That should make up the hedge. Please go to back to study one. We studied the hedge. The hedge. God's protection. The law. Don't have time for it now. And stand in the what? In the gap before me for the land. I want someone to intercede on the people's behalf, on their family's behalf, on the church's behalf, that I should not destroy it, but I found none. God's prayer. We are so quick to blame God. God, you don't answer my prayer. Are we answering God's prayer? His desire? He's looking for a man, for a woman that can intercede. God is looking for someone to stand in the gap. The powers of God's kingdom depend on your cooperation. A man or woman who can build a wall and stand in the gap. God is looking for people who can intercede for others, because we are in a war. I cannot overemphasize that enough. We're living our lives like, oh, it's fine, you know, there's war in Ukraine, you know, it's not here, so we don't worry. We are at war. Do you believe in intercessory prayer? Praying, interceding? God is looking for someone who can stand in the gap. As Jesus stood on the cross between God and man, what did He pray? Father, forgive them. Even when all infernal powers were against Him with our eternal lives at stake, Christ prayed and interceded for you. Even when the Father was shrouded in darkness and Jesus was separated from Him by our sin, Christ still prayed in complete darkness. Now then, Daniel goes on and he goes to Michael. Who's this Michael? Who's this Michael who has to help Gabriel fight evil? Please write in your study guide, Jesus Christ. In my study guide, I wrote, Jesus Christ, the divine warrior. Because this is who he is. He's the what? He's the divine warrior. Please go to the page 11, the bottom paragraph. Now, some Christians have a real issue when you say, Michael is Jesus. Like, oh, Jesus is no angel. Let's quickly just stand still for a moment and reflect on this. In your bottom paragraph of page 11, Michael cannot be someone other than Christ. His very name in Hebrew means the one who is like God. Now that says it all. Here in Daniel 10, Gabriel tells Daniel that this Michael is one of the chief princes. Now it sounds like, oh, he's one of many. If you go back to the Hebrew, it's actually in the singular form. It actually says the one chief prince, or it says the highest ruler. That's what it says in the Hebrew. This can only be Christ. Therefore, Gabriel assures Daniel that Michael is what? Your prince. Because Christ has pledged himself to us as our Savior and King before the foundation of this world. And then later in this prophetic time travel journey that Gabriel will take Daniel on, Daniel sees how Christ will stand up for us. Amazing. We find this in Daniel chapter 12, verse 1. What an amazing text. And at that time shall Michael stand up. Do you see that? That great prince which standeth for the children of thy people. Now, question. Who's going to stand up for us? The Bible says it's Jesus throughout the scriptures. Now here returns him Michael. You know why, Michael? Because we are at war. And this is the term used for Christ as warrior. Yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses. He durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke thee. Do you see that Michael has authority over Satan? You know why? Because Christ created Lucifer in the first place as a perfect angel. He has more power over him. And so only Christ has authority over Satan. So why is Michael described here as an archangel if Christ is not an angel? The term archangel in Greek means chief of the angels. Christ is the chief warrior or captain of the angel warriors. Isn't that amazing? So everywhere, he's the archangel. Yeah, he's the head of the angels. He's not a created being. Listen to what Thessalonians says, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven, that's Jesus, with a shout, with the voice of the what? The archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall what? Rise first. So that is why John says, Jesus is in John chapter 5, the hour is coming and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of who? The Son of God. So we see this is totally Jesus, it can only be him. Revelation chapter 12 says, and there was what in heaven? War in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. And the dragon fought on his angels and prevailed not. The angels are under the command of Christ, Michael the warrior. But it's Jesus Christ. And only Jesus Christ has authority over Satan. And neither was the place found anymore in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. Let's go back to Daniel chapter 10, verse 14. Daniel chapter 10, verse 14. We're going to go now to the last part of Daniel's experience here in his vision. Gabriel tells him now I am come to make thee understand what shall befall thy people in the latter days. For yet the vision is for many days. Please note, he says, I'm going to show you the future. I'm going to take you far in the future, go on this prophetic journey. But you're going to also understand the 2,300-day prophecy more, the vision, the mare. That's the word there for vision. Okay? So that is just incredible. I'm just going to go to this structure here on your study guide. Something is happening
And it's very important you see this with your own eyes. If you have your study guide, please go there. It's on page 13 at the bottom. Here we see something marvelous happening, okay? Gabriel is now ready to take Daniel on his prophetic time travel vision as he has strengthened him, encouraged him, and explained what is about to happen. However, Daniel is extremely weak at this advanced age. And Gabriel has to repeat the process of preparing Daniel for his time travel prophetic journey. So we see the parallels happening where Daniel is first prepared by Gabriel. We see it first, he hears and he falls. Then Gabriel comes to strengthen him, encourages him, emphasizes that the time is of the essence. And then he explains to him what is about to happen. He's going to take him into vision. He's going to take him to the far future. But then you find in verse 15, he's still very weak. And then Gabriel repeats this process of strengthening him, encouraging him, emphasizing that the time is of the essence. Daniel, I need to do it now. I don't have a lot of time to do this. And then he explains to him what is going to happen again. He's going to take him into vision now, and he's going to see with his own eyes, in vision, what the future holds, and how Michael will be the warrior throughout. Do you see this picture? Do you see the picture? And so now we find in section 5, Daniel is strengthened once again. We see this in verse 15 to 17. And when he had spoken such words unto me, I set my face toward the ground, and I became dumb. And behold, one like the similitude of the sons of men touched my lips. You will see this later in chapter 12. Then I opened my mouth and spake and said unto him that stood before me, O my Lord, by the vision my sorrows are turned upon me, and I have retained no strength. For how can the servant of this my Lord talk with this my Lord? For as for me, straightway there remaineth no strength in me, neither is there breath left in me. And so here's the question. How do we know Daniel is still in vision as him and Gabriel is talking, and Gabriel is talking to him, preparing him to take him on this prophetic time travel into the future? Please write there in your study guide. Daniel describes what happens to his body as Gabriel speaks to him. This is very important. Okay, so he describes the phenomena that only true biblical prophets experience when they go into vision. Do you see this? And so here is the parallels you see. Daniel's body during vision seeing Christ in the first part of Daniel 10. And the latter part of Daniel 10, you see Daniel's body during vision seeing Gabriel. The same experience, which means he's in vision when encountering Gabriel. We see with Christ, his eyes are open. With Gabriel, his eyes are open. With Christ, his ears are open. With Gabriel, his ears are open. With Christ, he falls forward face to the ground. With Gabriel, he turns his face toward the ground. With Christ, he's physically unconscious. With Gabriel, he's physically unconscious. With Christ, he has no life in him. With Gabriel, he literally says he does not breathe. With Christ, he is emptied of all strength. With Gabriel, he's emptied of all strength. With Christ, he's supernaturally strengthened. And then with Gabriel, he's supernaturally strengthened. He's enabled to speak then. And both times, he's mentally prepared for the prophetic time journey he's going to take in Daniel 11 and 12. Do you see this? And then in verse 17, Daniel expresses his astonishment that he can speak despite having no what? Breath. So this further confirms he's in vision while Gabriel is talking to him. So let's go to verse 18. It says, then there came again and touched me one like the appearance of a man, and he did what? He strengthened me. Again, Gabriel strengthens him because he's a weak man. He's deep in his 80s. Okay? He's almost 90 and he needs the strength. Section 6, Gabriel encourages, emphasizes, and explains again. We're going to read the last three verses, and then we see it all come together. And he said, O man, greatly beloved, fear not. Gabriel talks now to Daniel. Peace be unto thee. Beautiful words. Be strong. Yes, be strong. And when he had spoken unto me, I was strengthened and said, let my Lord speak, for thou hast strengthened me. Now you can see, okay, Daniel is getting ready for this trip. He's getting ready to go into this prophetic vision into the future. Then said he, "Knowest thou wherefore I come unto thee? And now will I return to fight with the prince of Persia. And when I'm gone, lo, the prince of Grecia shall come." So he's literally telling him, the time is of the essence. We need to go now into this prophetic vision into the far future. And then he says in verse 21, "But I will show thee," okay, I'm going to show you in prophetic vision the future, "that which is noted in the scripture of truth. And there is none that holdeth with me in these things but Michael, your prince." Isn't that amazing? So in conclusion, Daniel 10 serves as an introduction to the prophetic vision in Daniel 11 and 12, where Daniel is taken into the far future, and it introduces us to Michael, the divine warrior who will fight for God's people. Amen? Wow. Because in Daniel 11, you're going to see, man, there are powers that are just breaking God's people. But there's one standing up, we see in chapter 12. Don't miss the next studies. So in application and conclusion, here's the question today. Will you call on Christ as your warrior amid this cosmic conflict, persevering in prayer? I want to say yes. I want to say yes, God, I see I'm in a war. Yes, Jesus, I want you as my warrior. Holy Spirit, help me to understand this conflict I'm in. Amen. May God bless us. Oh, Father, we thank you for Jesus. Help us to trust him more. Oh, Father, help us to see that we are at war. And you have given us your word and prayer as weapons of offense. Oh, Father, help us to see Jesus as our warrior too, going ahead of us, opening the way. And Father, we pray that we will pray more, that we will trust more, and that we may be faithful, interceding, standing in the gap. May the love of the Father be with us now. May Jesus be our divine warrior. And may the Holy Spirit seal all these words from now until forevermore. Amen.